Hi everyone, and welcome to the last part of the chapter of professional ethics. In this part, we'll be dealing with the chapters of the council general guidelines. So there are a total of around 11 chapters which are prescribed and given in our book for the CA final syllabus, and we will be looking at each of these chapters and the key contents in those chapters. So chapter 1, there is nothing to read here, it's just saying from where these council general guidelines are coming and from where they are drawing their authority. Chapter 2 is conduct of a member being an employee. So this is something which is connected to clause 2 of part 2 of the second schedule. So it says that a member of the institute who is an employee shall exercise due diligence and shall not be grossly negligent. So he will exercise due diligence on his part when he is doing his work. He will not be grossly negligent. This is connected to clause number 7 of first part of the second schedule. And another thing which we can derive from this is he cannot be disclosing information without having the authority to do so. Chapter number 3, it is kind of redundant now, because as per section 148 of the Companies Act, only a cost accountant in practice can be appointed as a cost auditor. The CA will not be appointed as a cost auditor. So this is kind of irrelevant now. Chapter number 4 is connected to clause number 4 of part 1 of the second schedule, which deals with providing of opinion in case of entities where the auditor or the CA or his partner or his firm has substantial interest. So what they have covered there is if the chartered accountant in practice or his partner or his firm, only those three points are covered there. But here it is an expanded scope, that is the relatives of the partners are also covered here. So even in cases of entities where the relatives of the partners have substantial interest, the chartered accountant cannot be auditing their financials. This is derived from section 141 of the Companies Act, 141 subsection 3, where that particular section covers even the relatives of the partners. And the clause 4 in part 1 of second schedule was not covering such part. It was not covering the entities owned by relatives. So chapter 4 of the council general guidelines is covering that. So that particular thing has been taken care of now. The scope has been expanded here. Chapter 5 deals with maintenance of books of accounts. So every CA in practice will have to maintain a cash book and a ledger at minimum. So they can maintain any book apart from this as well, but at minimum they need to maintain these two books. Chapter number 6 and chapter 8 have to be read together. Chapter 6 deals with the limit of tax audit assignments under section 44AB. So the limit has been specified as 60 tax audit assignments for one single chartered accountant. So if there are more than one chartered accountant in a firm, so in case of a partnership where there are around 10 partners, each partner can take up 60 assignments. So in total the firm can take up 600 assignments, and it is also allowed that one single partner can sign all the 600 files on behalf of the firm and the others. So in such a case, none of the other partners would have signing authority. But normally that won't happen in a practical scenario. And the other thing which they have given here is that if the same person is partner in more than one firm, then everywhere put together his assignments cannot exceed 60. So in case partner X is a member in XYZ & Co and in ABX, in both the firms put together his number of assignments can only be 60. So in such a case, the number of assignments which the firms can take up would be reduced. So in ABX, it would be 60 and 60 for A and B, and it would be whatever is the balance for Mr. X. And in XYZ, it would be for Y and Z, it would be 60-60 assignments. And for X, in both ABX and XYZ put together, it can only be 60. So ABX plus XYZ put together, there are 5 partners, and they can be having a total of 300 assignments. Chapter number 7 deals with appointment of an auditor in case of non-payment of undisputed fees. So this is very closely connected to clause number 8 of part 1 of the first schedule of this act. So there it deals with a case that the new chartered accountant, he can't be accepting an assignment unless he has communicated to the outgoing chartered accountant who was performing that engagement earlier regarding whether there were any professional reasons for him not to accept the assignment. So one of the professional reasons for not accepting the appointment is non-payment of the undisputed fees. So what is undisputed and what is not undisputed? So they have defined the term undisputed here. So in the financials which that particular auditor has signed, whatever was described, whatever was indicated as the audit fees. So in the financials, if they have indicated 1 lakh rupees as the audit fees and both the client and the auditor have signed their financials, then that would become the undisputed fees. So that particular fees will have to be paid to the auditor. In case they have not paid, it is a professional reason for the incoming auditor to not accept that appointment. The exception provided for that case is a sick unit. So in case of a sick company, even though they didn't pay fees to the outgoing auditor, the new auditor or the incoming auditor, he can accept the audit assignment. Chapter number 8 is connected again with chapter 6, as I told earlier. There it was tax audit assignments. Here it is statutory audit assignments. So section 141 subsection 3 clause G. So that specifies the limit of the statutory audit assignments which a chartered accountant can undertake. So it is 20 audit assignments per partner. And there are some exceptions as well. If you refer that particular section, you will get to know the exceptions that are there. There are about 3 to 4 exceptions which have been given for this computation of these 20 audit assignments. So the partner, in case of a firm, he cannot be accepting more than 20 audit assignments, and the same thing as in tax audit. So if the same person is a partner in more than one single firm, so if he is a partner in 2 to 3 different firms, put together, his limit cannot cross 20. So it is 20 audit assignments per chartered accountant. And number 9, chapter 9 is appointment as a statutory auditor in case where that person is already performing other assignments for those entities. So these entities which are specified here are PSU, government company, a listed company, and any other public company with a turnover exceeding 50 crores. So for in any of these companies, if a chartered accountant is performing some assignment and if he is requested to accept even the stat audit assignment, and the fees for stat audit is lesser than the fees for these other assignments, in such a case he cannot be accepting those assignments, or he cannot be accepting the stat audit assignment. So the stat audit assignment always should have a higher fees compared to whatever other assignments that he has been doing. And These three are the exceptions for the term other assignment. So if any audit is conducted under other statute or certification work which is required, representation before authority, so these are not included in the term other services. So whatever is the fees for this is irrelevant, and the chartered accountant can still accept the stat audit assignment in these cases. Chapter number 10 is appointment of the auditor when he is indebted to that concern. So there are two things which are given here. So if there is a limit which is specified as per the statute, then that particular limit will be taken, that particular limit is considered. If nothing is given in the statute, then 10,000 rupees is the limit. So if the chartered accountant is indebted for more than 10,000 rupees, he is ineligible to get that assignment. In case of Companies Act, 5 lakh rupees is fixed as the limit. So up to indebtedness of up to 5 lakh rupees is allowed for the auditor. Beyond that, he is ineligible. Chapter 11 is directions in case of unjustified removal of auditors. So if the previous auditor or the predecessor auditor has been removed in an unjustified manner, the incoming auditor cannot straight away accept the assignment. So he will have to follow the directions given by the Council of ICAI in such a case. So with that, we've come to an end of this Council General Guidelines. This page, you can totally skip this page. You need not go through this. And the Annexure 1 deals with the sections of the Chartered Accountants Act. You can just go through it once. And Annexure 2 deals with the sections which are related to the disciplinary procedures. So section 21 and 22 they relate to the disciplinary procedures under the CA Act. You can just go through that once. So with that, we have also come to an end of this chapter of professional ethics. There are four parts. This is the last video. The other three parts would be uploaded before this. And hope you got a broad level understanding of this particular chapter. And I hope that you can be scoring good marks in the 16 marks that are going to come from this chapter. Thank you for watching and all the best for your exams.